As we mentioned earlier, today marks 75 years since the atomic bombing of Hiroshima. Another blast hit Nagasaki 3 days later. More than 200,000 Japanese died in the two attacks. The horrifying aftermath has been told and retold by survivors through the years. The youngest of them are today in their late 70s and 80s. Now, a younger generation is trying to ensure that those memories are not lost. Special correspondent Grace Lee in Hiroshima has the story.
In a room full of his peers, 17-year-old Niho Ishibashi asks an important question.
How are you young people to learn the truth about Hiroshima now?
He learned about the horror from his great-uncle, a survivor of the Hiroshima bombing who lost his eyesight due to the blast.
When August 6th coming, I often go to his house and hear testimonies. Yeah.
Now, Ishibashi is sharing that testimony with his high school peace studies class. It's a regular part of the curriculum for many schools in Hiroshima, different from the rest of Japan. Takeda High School's program was developed by Vice Principal Muneo Hota.
My father was an A-bomb victim, so I'm second generation of Hibakusha.
Hibakusha is the Japanese word for survivors of the atomic bombings. With their numbers dwindling, the race against time to preserve their memories has been a rallying cry for young people in Hiroshima.
I would like to do something that I can keep Hibakusha's stories in the future.
Some have found unique ways to do just that. At Fukuyama Technical High School's computer club, students are working with virtual reality under the watchful eye of their teacher, Katsushi Hasegawa. They let me experience their project firsthand. With a headset and some earphones, I'm transported to Hiroshima in 1945, before the city is bombed.
We want people to know what happens when nuclear weapons are used. People tend to think about using it to attack others, but nobody thinks about what it's like to have the bomb explode right above your head.
Students here understand that message, especially when they're able to stand right on top of Ground Zero.
There's a park there now, but the site of the bombing used to be a town called Nagashima Honmachi. I hope that, by knowing that town existed and seeing it there through VR, people will be able to feel the reality of the atomic bombing.
It's awful to see that a place so beautiful could be turned into a pile of rubble like that. When you watch the moment of the bombing in the VR program, it happens in a second. There's a blinding light and everything is destroyed.
The students aim to show their project to as many survivors as possible in hopes of creating a more accurate version of a pre-bombing Hiroshima. Education about the bombing starts as early as elementary school in Hiroshima. This elementary school tells a story on its own. Located about a third of a mile away from the bombing's epicenter, the school's west wing was the only structure left standing after August 6, 1945. It was used as a relief station for survivors. This part of the school is now a museum. Several of its walls served as message boards for victims trying to reach loved ones.
This is a note from one teacher to another saying that a badly burnt student undergoing treatment has become orphaned.
Students here make paper cranes every year for the museum. They were seen as symbols of hope after the bombing.
Students know about what happened here. They learn about it in peace studies. The fifth and sixth graders are even trained to be guides for foreign visitors.
Hiroshima Archive is another massive feat by local students. It relied on student volunteers to gather messages from A-bomb survivors and put them onto a digital archive.
So the app shows you where survivors were at the moment of impact. So if you take a look here, you can see we're standing right where this survivor, Michiko Takano, was on that day. And if you click their names, you can see their testimony. This is hers. At that moment, there was a flash as if someone had lit a huge amount of magnesium on fire, and the house was blasted to pieces. For a moment, I thought our house was hit directly with an incendiary bomb. But when I looked around, the whole city was destroyed, and I saw people covered in gray ash standing in a daze on the street corners. It was like seeing a scene from hell.
This year, ceremonies marking the anniversary of the bombings have been scaled back due to COVID-19. And for survivors like Setsuko Thurlow, the pandemic has been a difficult time.
You know, when I saw pile of dead bodies of the COVID-19 victims, that reminded me of what I experienced in Hiroshima 75 years ago.
She still remembers vividly what it was like when the bomb hit her hometown.
Although it happened in the morning, it was dark, like twilight. And as my eyes got used to the situation, I started seeing some moving dark object nearing me. And that was a procession of injured people. Their parts of the bodies were missing, and the hair was all burnt and standing up. And the skin and flesh were hanging down off the bones. They were bleeding, burnt, blackened, and swollen.
Thurlow is an activist and a leading figure for the international campaign to abolish nuclear weapons. For advice to young people, reach out to local politicians.
Get in touch with them. Let them know how you feel. I think you deserve the decent future waiting for you. Your lives are just starting. You deserve better.
Her message is well received in Hiroshima, where the next generation has already been planting their seed.
Hibakusha is passing away a lot year by year, so we should keep this memory, this idea, for a long time.
And the generation after that is well on their way.
I'd like to spread any countries what happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
On August 6, 1945, 150,000 lives were lost in Hiroshima. 3 days later, another 75,000 people were killed in Nagasaki. 75 years have passed, but their deaths are still fresh on the minds for many here every summer. And every year, new voices are speaking up on their behalf. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Grace Lee in Hiroshima.